I was trying to think how I first met you and how we know each other. And I honestly, this is one of those relationships I can't put a moment on. I've known you for such a long time. I think it had to do with Jenny under the viaduct serving people food, which is something you have done. And maybe we can just start there and you can explain that little piece of what you do.
Reverend Jenny is with a ministry called Eagle Ranch, and I really don't know her that well, but I have been supporting her for decades. I found out that this woman would show up under the viaduct downtown, and she would manifest food on Sundays. She would not bring food, she would just manifest it, and she would feed all the homeless that would gather to her. And when I went down there, sure enough, that's what happened. And she was blaring Christian hymns and music and what have you, and it was all very happy and wonderful. And I just looked at that and I thought, how does she do this every week? It's just manifesting this love. And so as often as I could over the years, and particularly during holidays, I would get food. And when I was on public radio for almost 30 years, I would always be on Thanksgiving. And so I would rally anyone out there in the world to say, got an extra pie, run down and give it to Reverend Jenny. She was closed down just recently in the spring by the Salt Lake City Police Department because there are too many people gathering because of COVID. And I don't know if you've been to downtown Salt Lake City lately, but the homeless and the tents are numerous, more than I've ever seen in my entire life, and it's desperately needed. And even Black Lives Matter has gotten involved in Black Lives Matter Northern Utah in tracking down these people and trying to feed them, but they have allowed her to reopen. I was not around during this Thanksgiving, but I had several friends that helped her out. So that's that.
That is, it's important work, and you have been involved in that work and been someone who's been a voice to that work. You've also been a lifelong Girl Scout.
Yes, I have been. I was born in New York. We had to move to Arizona because of my father's asthma, but then we had to go back and forth to New York because my sister had leukemia and she was at St. John's Hospital there. And then I moved to Utah when I was 15. I was sent to Utah to reform when I was 15.
And what were you reforming from?
I had just given birth to twins. I had been raped by my stepfather, and I'd given birth to twins in a small town in Arizona where they had sent me and my rather abusive bio mother to sit out the pregnancy. And as soon as I birthed them, they patched me up and sent me to Utah that I had never heard of Utah before.
Where are those twins now?
Those twins are just turned 50. They are in California. They each have two grandchildren that I have two grandchildren from each of them. They are both PAs or the next level up. One works with preemies in LA hospitals. The other one works with senior citizens and their teeth. And my grandson is the youngest kid in the US Army to fly Black Hawk helicopters, and he will be training people to do that in the spring. Yay.
You're not proud or anything.
I'm so proud. I love them to death.
Well, the other way that we know each other, of course, is through your work in raising money for abused women throughout the state of Utah. And I first saw the Vagina Monologues performed in Salt Lake City, and you were in the cast. How did that happen?
Oh, good heavens. That was like 2 decades ago. And some friends of mine who produced the Broadway shows that started coming to Utah back then, you know, remember when we are like Broadway shows coming to Utah?
Shocking.
And one of them was going to be the Vagina Monologues, which the buzz was all over New York. What is this? Oh, it's a smash hit, you know, Eve Ensler. And my friends called me and said, we're bringing it to Utah. And one of the cast members, Roma Downey, can't make it. Could you be in this? And I'm like, yeah, right. I'm not like an actor out there looking for jobs or any of that. I'm not in the
But you
theatrical
have
at
acted.
all. Yeah, I mean, I acted in college, but and I'm always acting. Right. And I thought they were just pulling my leg. They said, no, it's between you and Kate Jackson from Park City. And we'll call you back. We'll talk to New York and call you back. And they called me back and said, oh, you're in. You're going to replace Roma Downey. And it'll be at the Capitol Theater. And we will run many, many shows there. And I thought they were joking. And I didn't know what it was. And I thought, oh, my goodness, am I going to have to perform naked? And am I going to have to memorize anything? Because I can't do either one. And luckily it's readings, and it was a wonderful experience with two actresses, professional actresses, and sold out crowds. And after I did that, Eve Ensler then gave the production to the world to say, if you want to produce this anywhere in the world during the month of February, V-Day, you can keep the proceeds, send us a little tiny bit of the proceeds to keep our office running, and you keep all the rest and give it to local charities. And so I began doing that, and I think we were doing five different productions around the Tri-City area, raising money for the YWCA Battered Women's Shelter, Peace House in Park City, the Rape Recovery Center, and on and on and on. And we've raised hundreds of thousands of dollars here in Utah by doing this production every year for 20 some odd years.
What does that mean to you to be able to have led that in this state?
I don't think of me as leading it, is because it's such a group effort to actually put this on, but just the fact that it continues and that every year people experience this for the first time and the cast gets to experience it, particularly at Westminster, where Westminster raises more money for the Rape Recovery Center than anybody else. And when we get those kids together, I mean, it's like a cast of 20 or 30, you can just see it change their lives in such meaningful ways to read these stories. And then some of them get to tell their stories. And that is the crux of the whole thing, being able to tell your stories. And I might add, telling my stories, I heard many years ago about a woman who had been so brutalized and raped in a part of Africa by some, you know, herd of soldiers for like 2 years, every single day being raped by strangers, being raped with objects, guns, vegetables, horrible, horrible things. And somehow this woman survived and got out of there and went to New York. And there is an organization in New York that deals with victims of torture to help them try and live a fuller life. And one of the things that they teach there is that you have to tell your story. And you have to tell it over and over and over again. And the more you tell it, the more you'll be able to heal, and you can help others heal, and you can help others tell their stories. So that's really what it's about.
So doing all those things that you have done in being, whether you would call yourself an advocate for female rights, women's rights, human rights, where are you focused today?
It never stops. And if we can do, for example, the vagina monologues for eternity, let's do it. There are just so many stories out there and so many issues and so many things now that have been hidden, I guess, by COVID. That's taken over everyone's minds and mindsets these days. And so now all of our nonprofits are suffering terribly. And we have to figure out how to keep them funded and viable during this time of pandemic, and how this is all going to morph in the future.
You have a big heart. You want to see changes happen within the state of Utah. Mm-hmm. What does that mean specifically for you in the LGBTQ community that you are a part of?
You know, for Utah, I think we're doing a fairly good job, but the fight is never over, and particularly for trans people. And there, I would, you know, the struggle is real, and it's not going to stop. And the more we can talk with our legislators and our lawmakers about making sure that equal rights for everyone, that has been a battle that I have had since I came out when I was, oh, probably, I'll say about 20 years old, and marched, and the marches aren't stopping. We have succeeded somewhat in being able to marry. I was lucky enough to marry my wife, and that is legal. And
at Burning Man, as I recall?
Our first time was at Burning Man because it was not legal in the state of Utah. And then when it was in the state of Utah, when it became legal, which was right around the end of the year, my Mormon real estate attorney called me the day that happened. He said, get down to the courthouse right now. I don't know how this is going to last. And we were one of the very first down there. And I have been marrying people since the 1980s as a universal life minister. And so I got up to the desk and I was right behind a legislator by the name of Jim DeBacchus, who was just being all silly and nervous about getting married. I was like, Jim, get out of the way. We want to get married. And I get up there and the woman goes, so who's marrying you? And I'm like, oh, I forgot I have to have someone to marry me. That's not me. So I had to run downstairs, my wife and I, and there were starting people to gather. And we're like, Chris, can you marry us? Come here. Yeah. So we had Chris Wharton, who's a city council person now, marry us. And here we are. And the world did not crack open.
No, it didn't crack open. And in fact, it got more open.
Yes. And it got better for us. And it still needs to be better. Again, the struggle's real.
Any advice for young people anywhere who are trying to figure out how to be their authentic selves?
I really envy those folks, younger people out there, because they have connection. Even if they're home and they're not allowed out of the house because of COVID, or if they're introverts, afraid, no matter what, if they're connected onto the internet, there is so much information out there and so many organizations willing to help that can do this, do a live Zoom, that can talk to you on the phone, that can help you, which I never had ever growing up. And not until my 20s was I able to ever get any effective counseling. So there's that. And there's, you know, always this magical phone and so many things on this new thing, TikTok.
Oh, is that so much fun?
It is a great relief to have TikTok, I must say.
Yeah, it's amusing, but it's also maybe a form of citizen journalism.
Oh, I like that. Yes. And it also depends on how you subscribe to TikTok. If you're just doing fuzzy animals, well, that's fun. But
Yeah.
If you want to learn, there's so much to learn out there. But how nice for these kids to have such support at their fingertips, really.
Well, Babs, you are, you continue to be such a great influence in the state of Utah. You continue to do great work, and I can't wait to be doing V-Day in person again, even if we have to Zoom it this year.
Yes.
To continue to raise money for the Peace House here in Park City.
Absolutely. And please give. And every month, I make a donation every month. It just comes automatically out of my account. Goes to the Peace House, goes to the YWCA. You won't even miss it. $5, $10, just give. We have to. This is how we pay it forward.